So today I'm going to introduce you a little bit what is doing Universal, how is doing the music market, what we've been trying to do or doing at the moment to do better, escape a little bit from the record crisis, and give you a few tips about how we are moving and how we feel we're going to move within the next 10 years. And after that, my presentation is going to be about international, you know, being a local artist. How can you try to succeed international? How can you hopefully sign with a label outside your country? What are the tips you can develop and the strengths you have to work on in order to make it global? Is it better to deal with a big label? Is it better to go with an indie label? All that kind of question you may have in your life of being an artist, or you may face sometime and somehow in your career. And at the end, I hope I'm going to have a few time to be able to get a few questions and answers with you. So the first thing, it's about me, and our job on a daily basis is to develop the career of artists we just signed. So I'm working only for international artists, and we are developing the catalog from Interscope with the biggest label in the US. They've got Dr. Dre, Eminem, 50 Cent, Lady Gaga, Madonna, the Black Eyed Peas. All these artists are the artists I'm taking care of the career in France. On one side, we develop what we call the baby band. They are just brand new artists they sign, and some of them we just listed here, and some of them are from the US, some of them are from other territories, because on top of working with the US, sometimes we pick up artists on different other territories. The young professional with Ivry, we just pick them from Israel, Lucas Grimey from Denmark, Lena is from Germany, Carly Rae Jepsen, you know her from the song Call Me Maybe, is from Canada. And we develop them from using marketing and promotion action on a daily basis. The second step, I would say, is to market and promote the artists who are already big stars, trying to promote and market their new release and make it as big as the previous one or even bigger. Among the artists we work, I told you some of the names listed above. So let's talk a little bit about Universal Music. We've got three main activities making all of revenues. Music recording, that's the big part of our job, producing artists, producing content, producing recording albums. Music publishing, we've been really developing the publishing aspect over the next years. We bought part of BMG a few years ago. And the third thing is merchandising. We bought a company called Bravado. It's a German company. They are dealing with all the merchandising with artists, t-shirts, anything, posters, everything you can sell on top of your music. The turnover is over 4 billion euros in 2011, and we made 507 million euros of profit. Universal in the world right now, it's over 25 labels. It's even more today because we just bought a few months ago EMI, which is another major company, and it's going to be about 30 labels at the end of this year. The market share for Universal is 38.9% in the music business. This is kind of huge. In France, for instance, we represent 42%, and by buying EMI, we're going to be almost reaching 50%, which means one record out of two distributed in France is by Universal, which is pretty big. We belong to Vivendi. I don't know if you heard about this big multinational. Vivendi is working with music, but also we produce video games. We've got two companies of video games. We produce movie. We've got Canal Plus TV and Canal Plus TV, the movie channels. And we also have telecom investment. We are working with Maroc Telecom, for instance, SFR in France, and a big company also in Brazil. Let me speak about specificity of the music market. So, nothing new for you, I hope. Well, as you know, it's been decreasing. That's, you know, when I started my job, it was 12 years ago, it was totally different. We had money, we had success, it was easy to promote and market the artists. They were pretty, the rules were more or less the same. But, you know, it started decreasing in 2001, and the market from that time decreased by 70%. Which is a lot. We can explain that, of course, piracy is a big problem. with private copies, the fact internet, you know, high speed really increased, gave the possibility to everybody to download really fast and easily. Mobile also developed pretty well, so people can now, you know, get the music everywhere easier, faster, don't need to buy a record to get something. Maybe also we get touched because of the pure quality of the music. Let's face it and be honest, you know, some of the albums we've been recording and releasing over the past year sometime were really poor. You had one track and the rest were shit, to be honest with you. So I think it didn't help the consumer to trust in our services and the quality of a label to develop a brand. Some social network and some social programs, like the real TV shows. It's a good thing, but it's a bad thing on the other hand. And some programs like Pop Idol or X Factor or whatever, it's good to put an artist on. But on the other side, it's making people feel that whoever you are, you can be an artist. Like, I'm a good singer in my bathroom, and from the day to another, I can turn into Lady Gaga. This is totally wrong, okay? Don't, and people think too much about it. Thank you. And also, we had some programs, I don't know here, but some, you know, special program about how record company market an artist, you know, how fast we can be with finding an act, and she's a no one, and we record a track, and it's taking 4 hours, and she becomes the hit of the summer. This is part of the business, but thanks to this cash money we make with this, you know, one-hit wonder, it's giving us the possibility to develop and invest more on all the artists that need time and forces and money to be exploded after that. We've been slow also, really slow in reacting against the piracy. There is almost no rule to protect, you know, our music and the content. Therefore, we didn't react slowly. I know I was working in the US before, and when I come to France, there were no internet high speed. And I know my record company was saying, yeah, it will never happen. It's too slow. It's taking 3 hours to download a track. And then high speed came for a cheap price, and everything started collapsing. And instead of being ahead and trying to find new solution, we've been totally ignoring the problem. And right now, we are in trouble. I told you weakness of the laws. Actually, it's going to be part of the subject after that. But there is almost nothing in the law protecting artists' content. It can be music, it can be cinema, it can be anything you create. It's kind of complicated to put someone on the trial for that. Less exposure also on the mass media, mainly on TV and radio. The more you listen to the radio, the more it's about the talk show and less it's about the music. If you listen to the big, you know, radios over Europe in the morning, you've got the morning talk show. In the evening, you've got the evening talk show. So it's less exposure for the music. On the other side, on TV, before we had a lot of TV shows. It can be everywhere, actually. With music acts, you know, I remember when I was a child in France, every Saturday night we had the big show with all the acts coming and performing. Right now, if we've got it once a month, it's a miracle. So it's giving us really problems to expose the music. So the market, I'll explain you, decreased because of physical sales. It did -3% from 2010 to 2011. The only way it's balancing is thanks to digital that are going up to 8%. Publishing rights are doing better, also 5%, and synchronization deals, meaning having your music being used in a commercial or in a TV movie, up to 6%. So far, physical sales, it's still 61% of the market share globally, so physical sales still represent the large part of your business. Digital is increasing 31%, publishing 6, synchronization 2. So that, sorry, it's in French, but I will tell you. You've got a country, of course, United States, Japan, UK, Germany, France, that's the top 5 markets in the world. And that the how much digital is split, actually. If you're a country, in the United States, 49% of your digital sales are made by a la carte track, which is just downloading one single, 34% by albums download, 5% by mobile download, and 12% by streaming. this graphic is pretty much important because you see more or less the average with streaming and subscription right now is around 15%, 40%. France is going by 40%. And if we take the case of Sweden right now, they make all their digital revenue from streaming. 80% of the music right now in Sweden, it's 80% by streaming with platforms such as Deezer or Spotify. So I know here it's not happening. You don't have it, okay? But it will come, actually. That's one of the key things for the future. People paying every month a certain amount of money to be able to access all music they want, everywhere, anytime, but you don't own it, which means the day you start, you stop subscribing to it, you do not have it. In Sweden still, the first 6 months of this year, it was representing 90% of the business. So even iTunes is not any longer sufficient in Sweden. Everybody is making money on the top of Spotify and Deezer. Okay, and that's the split in between physical and digital. So you see that Korea, United States, Sweden, almost, and Canada and Australia, almost half of their sales and the revenue, they make it on the back of digital revenues, and half of it is from the physical sales. After you've got other markets like UK, Spain, Japan and France, it's about 20-30%, and other markets where it's still really more physical and less digital than today. Okay, this graph is pretty much important for you because it's going to be part of my subject after a while. You don't really see clearly, actually. It's giving you the difference in between the local repertoire and the international repertoire. In each market, what is selling most? Is it international artists or is it local artists? You see that in the United States, so in blue you've got the classic repertoire, in yellow you've got the local repertoire, which is the local act, and in green you've got the international repertoire. In the US you see that 93% of the market shares, it's their own signature, which means if you're an international artist, it's tough, okay? You've got 5% of change to make it. France, it's still really big, 59% of the sales, sorry, yeah.
But do you count as well, like artists that are not from the US and like came to the US to
absolutely.
Do their music, it's still in the orange?
It's here, no. Artists who are not American, okay, like UK or even Australia or France or everything, who are working, who made it in the US, they represent only 5% of the turnover. Is that clear or not?
Yeah. But in the MTV, mm-hmm. all the foreign music is the most popular. So
yes, but most of them are American. But on MTV, MTV has got local, you know, channels. So the MTV you're seeing over here is not the same. They are broadcasting in the US. So maybe you're gonna see a lot of international stuff on the MTV in Israel or in France, same goes. In France, we've got, you know, French act on the French MTV. But if you go in the US, it's gonna be all about, you know, Black Eyed Peas, Lady Gaga, Madonna, blah, 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 50 Cent. And maybe at one step, you're gonna have one UK act or one act from Australia, but maybe the only international, like Psy, for instance, with Gangnam Style, is part of this 5%. Because it's coming from Korea. But that's really, really little. And so you see that, you know, in some other markets like France or Italy or Germany, the local repertoire is still really big. And other markets like Spain, Sweden, or UK are really more diverse and 50-50 in a way. So let's keep on moving, actually. I'm gonna just walk in. All right, so evolution of our business. So even if the market is still collapsing, the music consumption is bigger every year. We've got music everywhere. Even if we sell less, we consume more. And this way we try to find solution to get other kind of revenues. So what we did from our side is that we try to sing different. Meaning music is not the main revenue any longer, but the key to access other sources of revenue. It's not about your record sales and wondering how many albums you're going to sell right now. It's wondering about, thanks to your music, who are you going to be able to reach and what kind of money you're going to be able to make on the back of it. It can be different sources, and I will explain that later on. We've been keeping on signing new acts, no restriction. When people are saying that there is less and less offer, it's wrong, actually. There is less and less exposition in the media, but there is more and more signings in the record company. I know we've been investing a lot in signing new acts, finding new NR, and new signature has been done in the past. Focus strong on the local repertoire. That's what Universal has been doing a lot. Why? Because the artists who are local are on the territory. We don't need to fly them from abroad to come to record the album, to do promotion, to market them. And on top, we've got better deals with them in terms of money, so we make more profit on the back of a local artist than on an international artist. It's more or less 10% more in terms of money. Diversification in other fields of activities. We've been doing a deal with Live Nation, so right now you've got artists who are totally globally endorsed by Universal and Live Nation. If you take the case of Madonna, she's touring with Live Nation, and we are having part of her record, and we are sharing mutual revenues on the back of her tour too. Product placement. Lady Gaga has been one of the queen over the past years with product placement. You've got a brand, they want to appear with you, so you play them on your video. It's a massive way to get your video paid and also to get money on the back of it. Lana Del Rey, she just did an endorsement campaign for H&M. I know it's been running over here and it's been pretty massive. It's good because it's giving her cross-marketing, promotion. She can reach people she would not reach with her music. So it's giving you a possibility to talk to a new audience and not only focus on the show or the marketing you're going to be able to do with your music. Enrique, I've been doing a big deal with Azzaro. It started in 2010. Is a new face of the Flagrants. Thanks to the campaign, Azzaro increased his sales by 20%, just thanks to his face. And same goes for him. It gives him the possibility to be on all the fashion press, on all the woman press, and everywhere he could not access, maybe with his music. So Music, that's a program we've been doing in France with La Société Générale, which is a bank. I know the Young Professional just did a new program with American Express over here, and it's called Blue by the Young Professional, and that's a really good way to be exposed in another way, and brands need you. I mean, there is nothing cooler than music. So if a brand need to be cool, they need to go with music. So how can you help them to become, you know, something cool in their way? Beats, the headphones, incredible success. They started from nowhere, actually. Monster is from Korea. That's a brand who is doing all these headphones. They were just working on cables before. So they had no idea about music. And they did this joint venture with Interscope, creating the Beats. And they came from almost nothing to the biggest retailers of headphones today. Their market share is about 49%. Right now, and it's increasing every year. That's a massive success story, and that's a really good case and way to promote the artist. We've been focusing on also achieving better results in publishing. That's what I told you. We bought part of BMG. Creation of 360 deals for artists. I guess you all heard about this, you know, precise term, which means we not only take money on the record sales, we take money on the touring, we take money on the publishing, we take money on your merchandising, every endorsement deal or private gig you might do, we take money on the back of it. But in exchange, we give you more money also to support your release, your campaign, produce your album and everything. We've been fighting competitors harder. One of the key of the Universal was fuck Sony. So it was that a big part of the campaign. So we had to, we took some artists from Sony, like artists who were resigning their contract or about to leave. we gave them better money, better deal to get them on board. We hired some people from Sony, like good A&Rs or good marketing person. We tried to have them coming working for us. We've been strongly developing the digital activities. Like everybody know, explore new markets and emerging territories. Right now, we saw the sales and we saw that it's decreasing in Europe and US and everywhere else. But in some markets like India, Asia, and you know, Latin America, there is still a lot of business to do. They do not consume music yet because the technology is not there. But you know, when you see how mobile consumption is going there, they all have mobile, but imagine when all of them are going to have a smartphone. Imagine when the high speed is going to be everywhere in this country. The number of people you can reach and can buy music or can, you know, download it with subscription or whatever, it's huge. So we're really investing in all these territories at the moment. Touring is also a big part. If you go in Russia, you don't make any money, you know, having your record. If you go in Latin America, that's the same goes. They do not have that much of album sales, but touring making a lot of revenue. So a lot of artists go to this country, just release an album there just to exist and be able to tour. New way of distribution and exposition of our artists. That's what I just explained to you with Lana Del Rey and the H&M campaign and other stuff. Embrace the online, develop the activities on the internet. Universal has been creating its own TV channel called Off TV, because we just say that we have the content. So we can make a special report about when the artists are coming in market, like backstage report, special interview, acoustic session. And instead of giving it for free to a website, we decided to produce it, but to own it and to be able to sell it or do partnership with other partners. And we've been creating also special application and all this stuff. Remember the basic but explore new strategies to market and promote our artists. I'm giving you the example of Kantor. It's a dance label in Germany. And Kantor, they are independent actually. They are belonging to Universal now, but they were independent at that time. Early 2000, they were really struggling because dance music were not popular. Everything was about hip hop and R&B. It was all the 50 Cent vibe or the Dr. Dre stuff. So at radio, they had no exposition. So they said that, okay, the video we've got are not broadcast and we are not playing on TV. So they created their own YouTube channel and they've been one of the first label to do it. And thanks to that, they've been really proactive pushing it. And nowadays they've got over 1 million people following them on YouTube, which is a massive way for them right now to reach every time constant customers thanks to their channel and expose their video way better than they would do on MTV or MCM or any cable. So that's pretty important. And the way we try also to develop. We've been pushing also with politics and lobbying. As I told you, there were no law to protect the content. In some of the market in France, we've got a new law called Adopi, and everybody really pushed hard for that. Right now, if you're a pirate and you're downloading illegally, you can get problem and we can shut down your subscription on the internet and you have to pay something. So thanks to that, the frequentation on peer-to-peer website decreased by almost 30% last year, which is a really good sign. And I know they are trying to do the same thing in Germany, and like when they close up website like, what was the name of, shit. Mega Upload, thank you. Yeah, it really helped up. So we really saw right after that, you know, peer-to-peer was decreasing and we had a boom in digital sales after that. We also, you know, pushed our artists to support music legal download. We've been strongly investing to develop digital services, push the French government to give us some help, also to finance the music, give us funds to support and submissions. And we did a big lobbying, mainly at radio, to reinforce the French quota. French radio have to play a minimum of 40% of French music. And same goes in some other territories. So, next step is how consumer habits and new media are changing the rules. The music industry have been changing a lot. When I started, it was the beginning of the CD era, I would say, but before it was all about the vinyl, then we've been to cassette, CD, and now it's all about the digital. And we just figured out that with internet, consumer can access the information and the content super fast, whenever they want, wherever they want. And instead of having us pushing the music and telling them, okay, this is what you have to listen, because we were really having an impact on the timeline, on the media, now it's fucked up. They decide and they know where to find, what to find, and how to find it. So the way they consume is faster than before. And we really had to react to that, and it totally changed the business nowadays and the way we are, you know, making the money. It's pretty obvious that, just look at the list before here below, I don't know if it's big enough actually, but that's the top 20 best-selling artists of last year. So just take 10 seconds to have a look at it and tell me what, you know, what kind of consequence you take from that. Okay, so I'm going to tell you. First, we've got Adele, then Michael Bublé, Lady Gaga, Coldplay, Bruno Mars, Adele again with the previous album, Justin Bieber, Rihanna again, Lil Wayne, Amy Winehouse, Beyoncé, Mumford & Sons, Lady Antebellum, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Drake, Foo Fighters, David Guetta, Kanye West, Susan Boyle. Yeah, she did big. So?
You make the most money.
Yes! But that was not. Yeah, we make almost 50% of the business, that's what I said. Now, if you look at the list, most of these artists are new. That's the thing. If you look at the list, only three of them have got more than 10 years of career. Most of them do not even have 3 years of career. Adele was not existing 3 years ago. Bruno Mars was not existing 3 years ago. Who else? Mumford & Sons, Susan Boyle, Drake, Lady Antebellum. All these people, Justin Bieber was kind of existing a little bit before. It's five, but well, the big international success, yes. He had no success before 3 years ago. They are all new acts, which means it's finished. The time you were a big artist and you kept on selling and selling and selling whatever you were doing, it's over. It's all about the fresh and the novelty. What people want and what people buy is everything which is new, which is totally changing the way we just, you know, do our business today. So we said that consumer can access info immediately. They've got eclectic taste. They switch easily from hip-hop to dance music. They go in a rock club in the evening, but in the morning they can listen to jazz. Before, it was not really existing. Everybody was more focused on one type of music, and it totally changed what people are consuming today. Faster way to consume. And we just figured out that what we call the LOP, which is a life of project, so the time, from the time you release an album up to the end of this, you know, exploitation, it's really reduced. 80% of the sales of a new album are achieved within 3 weeks. No, 3 months, sorry. Following in 3 days. Which means you release your album, you've got 3 months to sell it. After that, it's almost done. Only a few of them are able to extend it up to 1 year. And really happy few are having an album they work during 2 years. If you just look at the list, Adele, Lady Gaga, Rihanna, Amy Winehouse, David Guetta, that's it. Okay, so that's 4 or 5 on the list of 20. So that's really few.
I have a question about the...
Yes?
You're saying that only new artists can make a success.
No. I'm saying it's harder for...
It's harder for...
Yeah.
But if you show us the top 100, so there still be, like, you can see here Foo Fighters and...
Yes.
Probably Radiohead.
Yeah.
The top 100, but they will stay on here.
Yeah, of course. I'm not. I'm not.
Adele and Lady Gaga in 5 years won't be here in the same list. You
know they may be on the top 100.
they still be on
they
the
will still be in the top run or not, we don't know. But what, you know, people really want, I mean, the top 20, let's say it's 80% of the of the business. Okay, these are the one who really made it big. Look, you know, when you see the sales charts, it's a top 50 or top 20. And when you're number 100, how much are you selling? Nothing. Okay, so it's not really relevant. So the one who really made it are this one here. And I don't, it's just showing you that people go for fresh stuff. And if you're older artist, or if you've got a long career, it's not obvious that you're gonna be able to keep on being at the top. So. Yes, darling. That's gonna be the next purpose. So a few other stuff you need to know. That's what you were just saying. There is no longevity any longer. You've got almost 3 years to make it happen, which is more or less 2 albums. Before, record company were taking the time to develop an artist, and you could, you know, if you were not successful on the first, that was no problem. On the second, no problem. On the third one, on the first one, you were breaking, fantastic, and you keep on signing. Now it's finished. If you've got a record deal, getting 3 album deals in your deal is great. Okay, more and more it goes with 1 album, and everything else is option. So if you've got hits, don't wait for next time on the next album. Just shoot now. You have to be really precise and give everything from day one. They won't take, you know, too much time to develop your career. Statistically speaking, we just found out, which is sad, that if you do not make it with your first album, you've got 75% chance not to make it with the second one. So if you've got hits, go ahead, okay? So you do not have any luxury to, you know, wait for next time and keep on going better with the next album.
If you actually talk about the death of catalog sales, like for new artists, I mean,
it's
don't
actually
count on them to release a record that will keep on selling and selling and selling. For
well,
years.
You know, catalog is still existing actually, and it's still doing well in most of the market. But you know, it really depends on the way you work it. And if you're not aggressive doing special, you know, price campaign, you know, gathering like a rock campaign or rap campaign, it's not really existing. And you need to, you know, if you're an artist and you do not have a record company pushing it, promoting it properly, making it kind of alive in a way, it's not existing. Because you're disappearing in a way from your media. Except if you've got a new album and you keep on going with your own music, of course you can revitalize your own, you know, catalog and keep on going and new campaigns, but you need to keep it active.
So the dream of having like 2 huge bestsellers and then retire and live for the rest of your life in a castle in the Alps is, you know, it's a dream.
It's no, it's not a dream. It depends how, you know, it depends how big you do. If you do a number one, like if you do I Got a Feeling from the Black Eyed Peas, yes, you can get retired because you've got a number one and you... Yeah, yeah, we don't want. So if you've got a massive hit everywhere, yes, you can. But right now, if you just have, you know, a number one hit, that's not in your country, that's not enough. Except if you've got, you know, the thing is that, you know, look, the song you are listening right now, you know, like all these songs are the song from the 80s or maybe the 90s. But song from 2000, we listen right now, there are only a few who are as big as it was to keep on listening to it. So I don't know if I'm clear with my explanation.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
All right. So yes, we have to produce new music more often. That's the consequence of all of this. And the first one who came with this idea and was Lady Gaga actually. And I remember working with her that when she was just releasing The Fame, we were just out of working Just Dance, and we were about to work Poker Face. And she told me, well, Gigi, I'm working on new music. I was like, what? Already? She said, yes. I said, why? Because the fans want it. They want new music. I said, yeah, but you just released your new album, and it's going to be for next year. You've got time. She said, no. The fans want it right now. We need to produce faster. We need to deliver new content on a more regular basis. It's finished the time where you could sit during 3, you know, years in between doing an album. It's totally over. So they really worked on getting new content every time, and that's what we are doing right now. We are expecting our artists to work more often and deliver new music. If you look at all the major releases targeting the young audience, like Rihanna or Nicki Minaj, Justin Bieber, David Guetta, all these artists are coming with repacks, new tracks, EP and everything on a regular basis. It means a huge amount of work for every artist because it's kind of non-stop. It means you do not have to keep on doing the same thing. You have to come every time with something fresh, which is sometimes complicated. You have to work as a team. And it's better in a way for your label because instead of putting a lot amount of money and time working on 15 track album, they put a bit less money and time working on something which is easier. I'm going to give you an example from in Sweden. The more they go, the more they release EP. And we have a rule we call the 666. So it's kind of devilish, but that's what it is. It's 6 track every 6 months for €6, which is they do not produce any album any longer. Most of the pop band, they go in studio, work during 6 months, produce 6 tracks, release it, do promotion, a bit of touring, come back in studio. I think it's really smart because it's giving you a possibility to surf on the trends. And if, for instance, you know, you do a rock album, but it goes more electro, you can go easily more electro and faster than anyone else. If you've got the opportunity to work with another act from another market and do a local duet, instead of being stuck with your album and you've got 4 singles to work, you cannot do anything up to the end, you can quickly say, okay, it's finished with the EP, I record this track with you and I go with new opportunity. And it's a good way to keep on moving and do not spend that much money on recording and marketing and promoting, but instead of releasing an album every 2 years, you release 4 EP every 6 months. And at the end of the day, you're gonna be maybe doing more money thanks to that. So what's coming next? Digital will increase, of course. But we still have physical, and I think when I hear people say the CD will disappear, I totally disagree. I don't think it's gonna happen. Why? Because the audio quality is way better as it is right now. And we are working on having, you know, super high quality standard. We just released what we call the Super Audio Albums. That's DVD Blu-ray actually with 24 bits quality. Out of the studio stuff. So this is pretty much for the classic and jazz repertoire, but they are aiming at developing it for some, you know, big pop acts and that kind of stuff.
Are you developing a better digital format?
Yes, absolutely. That's going to be one of the points, actually. Sorry?
I didn't hear this question.
If we are developing a better digital format also, yes, definitely. Some people like physical also, for the collection. Some people love having the CDs and the items and everything. I would say if you've got a super proactive fan base like Kylie, Madonna, Lady Gaga, all these kind of, you know, artists who are creating craziness, you have to get physical because the fans want to own a piece of you, and that's a good way. Also, if you're good looking, like Enrique Iglesias or Justin Bieber, the fans need to get the picture of you. So all these artists, they still make some of them, like Enrique, for instance, is making only 10% in digital sales. Everything else is physical because the fans want to get the picture and the booklet and the poster and that kind of stuff. That's a reality. It remains a cool gift. They make every year they make a survey in France before Christmas asking people, okay, what are you going to buy in terms of presents? Last year, a record, it was number 10 on the list. This year, because of the crisis, it's number 4. So it's meaning there is still interest for music, and a record is kind of a cool gift still. We are developing the deluxe format, you know, all this, you know, special package with everything. It's really important for us. We just find out that for some of the artists, deluxe is representing 60% of the sales on the 2 first week of sales. And with some of them, it's 20% of the sales on the total LOP, actually. After the end, when you finish the recording and the exploitation, you just find out it's been 20%. It's key for us because we make more money on the back of it. It's more content, but it's more margin.
Excuse me, when you say deluxe format, do you mean like extra tracks?
Extra track, yeah, absolutely.
A DVD,
a bonus stuff, absolutely, yes, yes. And physical also give you the possibility to do, you know, D2C. direct to consumer, which means you have the album deluxe plus a t-shirt plus, I don't know, like a VIP ticket to meet the band. This is something you can do with physical products. So more and more it will also go, you can do it with digital, but physical is really helping.
The sales on sites like Amazon, didn't they provide the music in a wave format?
Yes, they do. They do both. They do physical and digital, Amazon. And but they are really good in, you can do pre-orders and they are really good at some numbers.
So I can download music in WAV format?
In the WAV format?
Yeah.
Yes, in Amazon, yeah, absolutely. And some platform also.
Okay. Like
so but you can also do it both physical and digital.
And digital, of course,
by
yeah.
By producing a USB device with a
Yeah, definitely. But I'm just meaning that the CD, I don't think it will disappear. When people feel it's not going to exist, I think, you know, in 10 years, the CD will still be there in a way, so.
Vinyl came back.
That's what I'm saying. 12-inch vinyl, surfing on nostalgia, and it's a cool product, you know. 5 years ago, vinyl was totally gone, and all of a sudden, it just reappeared because people think it's cool, it's a great item, we make, you know, picture disc. It's kind of classic, and it's nice. Digital will increase, that's true. It's all in one. My music accessible everywhere. That's what people want right now. Something easy, and especially the young audience. There are new platforms coming on. So I know iTunes is spreading everywhere. They open in some new markets. I know it's not there already in Israel. It's you can, but you have to get special cards or whatever. It's a nightmare, but it's gonna come. I think it's a good way to do business also for you. I know you're a musician or whatever, but these are companies you should target in a way. If you want to work in the music business, they're going to open local offices and they will have to get local people to work with the industry. So getting these people in your radar, like Deezer, you know, Spotify, all this kind of platform, if you want to work in the music industry, that's maybe something you should target because maybe there is a job for you there. I know also Beats by Dr. Dre, they're going to open a new platform called Daisy within the next month. And it's going to be mixed in between Spotify and iTunes. And I believe they will take all the artists to do the promotion and they're going to be really big otherwise. As you said, quality will increase in internet. We've got right now iTunes Master, which is a better quality. Cobuzz, which is a platform in France, aiming at having you downloading 24 bits quality. So this is also increasing on another step, and it will help to develop internet. Subscription, as a new rule, I talked about Sweden and how big it is. It's really important for us because it's a constant revenue every month. Even if we make less money on streaming, if we've got thousands and thousands of people paying every month a certain amount of money, that's a revenue we've got every month. And how many of you have been subscribing to something and at the end of the day, you don't really use it or you forget to, stop your subscription and it keeps on going months and months and you still pay.
So what you say, if you're willing to pay for something, you'll eventually use it because you paid for it.
Yes, some do, but some others don't. I remember for the TV. Sometimes you've got the pay TV, and at the beginning you use it, but after you do not use it because you get bored of that, and you forget to unsubscribe, or you cannot unsubscribe. So it's still a way to make money on the back of it. Social networking should help consumption, and we became a new place to sell. We start selling stuff on Facebook, Twitter, all this stuff are really helping. And they believe that within 2015, 15% of the online transaction will be achieved via social network, so an application. So start looking at making money on the back of Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, Instagram, whatever. Album sales to become application. Lady Gaga next album, she said she's gonna release physical, she released digital, but she will also create a special application where the fans are going to be able to pay every month for new content, which means you pay $1 per month and you've got the full album, but the months after you've got new videos, and after you've got special photos and making of and blah blah blah. And at the end of the day, it's people who are gonna pay $1 maybe during 3 years, and they're gonna give her $30 instead of giving $10 for an album. So it's a good way also to sing different and make other kind of revenue. You make less money on the short time period, but if you go long time, you make more money. So one question you may ask, can I do with or without a record company? So there are different ways to do it. Before, you had no chance. If you had no record company, you could not expose your music, you could not have it distributed, and it was fucked up. Today, we've got internet, and we've got, thanks to that, aggregators. So I don't know if you're familiar with that, but a lot of websites opened over the past year. And oh, it's good, it's in French. and these are platforms that are taking your music and distribute it on all other platforms like iTunes, Beatport, Deezer, Spotify, Juno, everywhere. So you've got one contact who is taking care of taking your music and it's spreading it everywhere, which means you don't need a record company if you need a distribution deal. Okay? And how they work, it's pretty easy. They take 10-15% of the money they make on the back of your music, and that's it. So some of them are kind of difficult to take, like Bassware, for instance. They are belonging to Beatport, who is, you know, the electro station for electro, you know, retailer for online. They are really precise with who they want to work with, and it depends on your music. But if you go with Imbaland, for instance, they don't care. You just have to subscribe. It's about €25 if you want to, you know, have one track distributed, and about €35 if it's an album. You go online, you subscribe, you send your music, that's it. And 3 weeks after, it's gonna be around the place.
So they caring for the publicity?
No, no. They only distribute. So. So that's what I say. They give you 80 to 90% of the net revenue. So I just listed the positive aspect and the negative aspect. So positive aspect, they bring you music to the digital platform within 3 weeks. That's what I say. They give you a big percentage on digital sales and streams. 80%, a label would give you around 20-25%, more or less. It's giving you awareness on your project at early stage, and it increases your buzz. It's meaning some of the artists, we find them because they're already on these platforms. Like a DJ, if he's number one on Beatport, it can be distributed without any record company, but maybe a record company is gonna say, ah, there is this DJ, he's number one on Beatport, who is that? And they're gonna check, they're gonna find him, and they're gonna give him a deal on the back of it. So it's a good way for you to be exposed anyway, and have a record company coming either with an offer or maybe a better offer, because maybe you've been approached by a record company, but the offer they're giving you is kind of not nice. And so you do it by your own, you make your buzz, and you go 6 months after seeing the record company saying, hey, look, it's happening. Do you still want my record? Yes, okay, but you have to put more money on the table. It's giving you access to some key platform majors don't work with. Universal is not distributed on Beatport, for instance, at the moment. And going through them is also a way to be on this kind of platform. It's a great way to expose your catalog online with potential cross-marketing and promo action. Some of them, like LabelWorks, for instance, you were asking about marketing and promotion. They can also do a little bit of online marketing for you, club promotion and that kind of stuff. Don't expect miracles. It's going to be kind of limited, but it's still something. The negative aspects, you need to come ready and all set. Okay, they don't just take care of distribution. So your tracks and album must be recorded, everything must be done, all legal clearance must be done. That's really important. If you use a sample, if someone is singing with you, blah blah blah, you need to get all this shit clear. Okay. because they do not take care of that. If you've got a problem or someone is suing you, they will sue you because you didn't clear it. So it's really important you come really perfect. You have to create your own artwork, so you need to have designer working with you and come with a full package. They won't really push for more visibility, and they are not helping you with any financial contribution or legal help or marketing and promotion. When you sign with them, they don't give you any advance. They just give you money 6 months after on the sales you're making. It doesn't include publishing, so you have to make your own publishing deal with a company or deal directly with publishing. And you have to deal with all the paperwork, getting the, you know, all the codes and ESRC codes and all this kind of stuff, and that can be painful. So my advice for that, it can work for indie label. If you're a really small label and you want to get your catalog distributed, that can be a good idea because it's a good way to expose it. And it's only one person you can speak to, and after it spread it to all the platforms, versus going to iTunes, going to Juno, going to everywhere and trying to find a deal. It's good if you produce your own music but you've got enough experience to be able to develop it by your own. If you've got your own PR, or if you've got people doing your marketing, or if you know designers, or all that kind of stuff, that's great. If you're alone and you do not shit, don't do it, okay? If your music is based on single success and you only make digital revenues and physical sales are not important, that's a good way. Like for a dance artist or a DJ, I think it's a really good spot to take. You also have to take care about your cost. If you, you know, make your music with not that much of cost and you can travel and you do not need that much of marketing, that's good. But if that's one step, you need some help financially speaking, that's not the ideal solution. There are other kind of platforms that just spread out in Europe, and you should check because it can be for everyone. One of them is called My Major Company. I don't know if you heard about it. No? Okay. It's a participative label. It means you submit your project online, and fans can support you financing it, which means I've got a record, but no one wants to sign it so far. So I'm gonna upload a video explaining, you know, what I want to do, and I've got my music and I play you a first tech track. Please help me out within a certain amount of time to gather enough money for it to be produced. So the average is 60,000 euros, something like that, and to reach within 3 or 4 months. And if you reach it, the record company, My Major Company, is producing your album, producing your first video, putting money on the table for marketing and promotion. And they've got a special deal with Warner for the distribution and the marketing. So we had huge success a few years ago thanks to that. The first artist who came out from this platform is called Grégoire. It was in 2009, and he sold 1.5 million records in France. It was the biggest seller of this year. And the way they split your revenue is 60% of the money you make is for you, 20% is for My Major Company and Warner, 20% is for the fan, which means the fan invest in your music initially, but they get money in return. So this is kind of a cool way to do it. Same goes, quite innovative. It's helping you to finance it from day one, and you do not have to put that much money on the table from your side. It's great revenue for the artist, 60%. It involves your fan from the day one, so it's cool because you've got a strong relationship with them. It can work with auto-produced artists or small label. And it's good to help you to hype your profile and get media attention. For instance, they had other acts called Irma. She raised 40,000 euros in 3 days, which was absolutely record. And thanks to that, they send special newsletter to the media saying, hey, man, we've got this new artist coming out. She raised a huge amount of money. Everybody's enthusiastic. So the day she came out with a record, everybody was, you know, already knowing her thanks to this buzz. Negative aspect, a lot of contestants, a few winners. So it means a lot of people are trying to break through that, but only a few make it. It doesn't mean you will make it successful. Okay, you have a record, great. You've got the money, you've got the fans, but you still have the media who are here to play or not to play your music, or support you or not to support you. You belong to your fans. So that's a good thing, that's a bad thing. It means if they are leaving you, it's sad. it's a fast way to develop, but it can also be kind of gadget. People, you know, it's a bit marketing driven, I would say. So it's sometimes not that you have to show after that that you are a credible artist, that you are great and everything. So you're coming a little bit with a cheap envelope, I would say. Other albums are options, which mean you go, you are produced for your first album, and what kind of financial support is my major company is going to give you after that? Okay, are you going to be able to deal with the same amount of money with the same kind of support? Do I speak too fast? Maybe. No. You sure?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Because blah, blah, blah.
Maybe you have a plane to catch.
Yeah, no. I'm here to tomorrow, so I'm good. So. So signing with a record company, it's the traditional way. I would say the positive aspect, you're working with professional, okay? So we've got a strong experience and savoir-faire in every domain. You're working with experts. So A&Ring, legal, finance, marketing, sales force, distribution, whatever. This is our job and we do it better than anyone else, okay? And that's why we keep on moving. We are financing your project, so we're giving you money to record your album, and we're giving you an advance to be able to own your living during all the time we're going to explode your album, which means if you do not make it, you still have the money and you still can keep on paying the rent and be able to eat and everything. We give you the possibility to open to big networks. We know media, we know retailers, we know all these people, and that's really a key. We can drive you in your R&R's process, which means helping you to find producers, A&R, mixers, featuring, collaboration, all that kind of stuff. We give you the possibility to have all the distribution resources, and that's really key when you go to a record company. You know, the force they have to get your album exposed in the shelf, the possibility to get a better deal on iTunes and be on the front page and all that kind of stuff. We've got big capacity to take risks and, you know, really invest on your album. So many artists, you know, in the beginning, we are all losing money on the first album, more or less. You know, we put a lot of money recording it, we release it, and after we pay and promote it. That's something not a lot of company can do, and it's a huge investment. And if you go with a big label, they're going to be able to take some risk. If at one step they feel you're going to explode, they're going to put maybe more money on the table, TV advertising or launching a big campaign, another, you know, smaller label won't be able to do. We are helping you with all the legal matters, and that's really important too. A lot of artists can be in trouble, not doing the right things or forgetting to clear something. And if you've got another company, you know, suing you for that, you can be in big trouble. We can loop you with other people. As I said, publishing, booking agent, promoter, merchandising company. We've got these 360 deals. We've got the network to spread internationally. For instance, if you sign with Universal, we can sign you for the world. And we've got, thanks to our affiliate, the possibility to work you on different territories. Facility to deal with paperwork and royalties. That's something which is kind of tough to get the money from the different countries you're working with, and the record company is in charge of that. Investment on a medium and long time partnership. You sign with, you know, 2, 3, 4 albums, and that's something pretty good. Negative aspect, welcome to the world company. Yes, we are here to make money, okay? Don't think we are, or labels are, fantastic people aiming at spending so much money, they love it, okay? We want money. And so it's a big structure. We've got a big power, but sometimes we also have less reactivity because we are big, we are moving in a slower way. So we've got all the administrative, you know, problem, all the hierarchy, all the international rules. Sometimes for people coming from abroad, when you are used to work with all your friends and all your network and be super reactive, and I do that and he's going to do my video and I can get that for free. With a label, it's more complicated because you've got to get contracts signed, blah, blah, blah. So you can feel sometimes that they are sleeping. They're not sleeping. It's because it's slower. There is a lot of international internal competition. You're not the only act, okay? You've got one carrier, but they've got thousands of artists. So don't have in mind that, you know, they can work with you every time as deep as you would like. And if it doesn't work at one step, whoosh, thank you, goodbye. That's sadly the rule. Less human resources than before because of the crisis. We've been, you know, putting a lot of people on the dole. So imagine that a product manager nowadays, they've got 10, 15 projects to work at the same time, which means they cannot focus as deep as you would like on every single project. They focus on the one that are gonna, you know, make it profitable and can make a lot of money. Smaller percentage on sales and revenue compared to what we saw just right before. India major, so it really depends what you want to do, who you are, and a few questions you have to ask is what type of music I am making. If you're making indie underground music and it's gonna be niche, and you better go with indie because they're gonna work you in a deeper way than, you know, a major would do. On the other side, if you feel you've got a potential to cross over and to go mainstream, maybe it's worth going with a major because the time you're gonna need, you know, a big push in terms of money and marketing and promotion, they may do better and have the resources to do it instead of an indie label that will struggle at one step putting more money. If you want to go mainstream, not that much of choice. I believe an indie label won't be interested anyway, and you have to go with a major. What kind of media should you target and could support your music? Are they specialists or are they mainstream media? If they are specialists, it's mainly indie. If they are mainstream or a mix of both, label might be more appropriate. What kind of support do you need? Do you need a lot of money? Do you need a distribution deal? What is the key for you? Just ask yourself what you need and who can really give you the strength to succeed. Distribution is physical key. If you really need to get your album on the shelves with big POS, listening post, all that kind of stuff, you better go with a big label than an indie because we've got more force with the retailers to make our deals. And what kind of artist you want to become? That's a big question, and that sometimes it looks stupid, but that's the reality. And sometimes we are signing artists and they don't want to be famous. And that's a problem because we are trying to push them to make it big and make it happen, and they do everything not to be famous. Meaning, you know, canceling promotions, yelling because you're TV advertising. So if you want to remain cool and indie and just want to have your local fame, go with an indie partner. If you want to be Lady Gaga, you'd better go with a major. Okay, so now it's all about going international or global. So we saw on the graphic before that Sony was a market, it's really hard to penetrate. If we look at France, it was 59% of the market share. It's all about the French music. And right now it's super, super hard to, you know, compete because almost everything is UK repertoire or US repertoire or English spoken, and the rest is almost not existing. So we've seen that still there are, you know, exceptions and people making it. In the classic and the jazz repertoire, it's not that much about, you know, the language, it's about the way you perform it. So it's all about, you know, either you perform in a different way or you perform in a better way. But the different stuff you use can make the difference. In the world music, everything which has kind of, you know, something exotic can make a difference sometime. And we had a few acts that made it internationally. Salif Keita is, for instance, made it big. Khaled, Tarkan, all these artists had a kind of a success story. The Latin family also is making kind of success abroad. If you take acts like Zucchero, for instance, or Juanes, they had some kind of big success outside their own country. Artists with a twist, which are kind of special. Ozone, Tokyo Hotel, Alize, Psy. That's the artist that made kind of a difference and really get possibility to export their music. As far as friends is concerned, except Daft Punk and David Guetta and all the electronic thing, we didn't have that much. We had Mylène Farmer, Alize did okay, Stromae, Vanessa Paradis, Zaz, that the few we get the chance to export. And if you look at the numbers, the international exportation for us it's 3% of the turnover every year. So that's really a small portion. But it still can happen. And the common point they have, all these artists listed, they've got hits and a huge success in their home territory, and or they've got something fresh, new, original you don't have. If you want to break a mold, that's the two options you have to take care. Am I unique? Okay, am I special? Is there anyone like me? If the answer is no, that's a good point. I am big in my country. If I'm a superstar, it's going to be, of course, easier to knock on the door of other label at international and get some attraction. Do not care, you know, what I was saying about the result, about sales results, because we are looking at other stuff, like the airplay results you can get in club. For instance, if you're number one in Turkey in the club, that's something that can be interesting for someone. The number of followers and tweeters you've got, the number of Facebook likes, that's something we really, you know, are looking at right now. Your popularity in the local press, website, media, the number of streaming, any kind of big tour you must have been doing, every kind of story, anything you can tell to interest a label, use it. Okay, do not focus only on I'm record, you know, my record is gold or platinum in my country. That's all the key thing. Synchronization also is something we really look at. Get originality and talent. That's obvious, but that's what it is. What are your strengths? Is it your voice, the way you play, your look, the way you perform? Why are you so special? So really work on pushing it and, you know, show what you've got and what you can provide to a new label. Do you have your own vision? It's really important right now that I know American people, they sign artists right now when they've got a vision. Like Lady Gaga, she had a proper vision of what she wanted to do, where she wanted to go, what she wanted to say. So if you've got your own vision, that's a really good tool for you. Don't make it too complicated, okay? If you've got a vision, if you've got a project, keep it still simple. And people have to get it fast. If it's too complicated, the record company will, I don't understand anything. And the media and the people won't understand anything. So keep it easy. As said, record company will more easily sign something they don't have in the catalog. So if you're Lady Gaga number 13, I don't think there is a spot for you because there is already a spot taken by Lady Gaga. But if you are someone we don't have in the catalog, that's good. Another option is when a record company is trying to compete with another record company. For instance, Sony is having One Direction. Okay, this crazy boys band from the UK, they are doing extremely well. So every major in the past 6 months, they've been working on having their own boys band. So you had the boys band from Warner, you have the boys band from Sony, you have the boys band from Universal, and blah, 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 and all of them will compete together. So it's giving you a possibility if you're, you know, that boys band to get a deal. So you can use that. If one artist is successful and you're more or less the same type, you can also break things to this. Mind the quality level of your work. If you want to go international, you cannot come with a demo, okay? It has to be at the same level American do or European do or anyone else. You cannot come with, you know, something which is as not good in terms of recording, in terms of imagery, in terms of video. If you don't have money, have ideas. I think, you know, it's complicated to, when you watch MTV, all the videos are just crazy. They spend $1,000, you know, making it. We cannot spend everything, but maybe a good idea can have a better result than a lot of money.
Like Lana Del Rey with the cell phone?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's, you know, I mean, this video costs almost nothing for her. She did it by her own, you know, taking up pictures and footage from other stuff. And she made it and it did big. So a good idea can make it happen better. Pay attention to your accent and be fluent in English. How many artists came to us and they are like, do you speak English? No. that's a problem, okay? If you sing in English, sing properly in English, because otherwise, it can sound a bit exotic and interesting. People may like it, but if you're targeting the US or the UK market, if your English is not perfect, forget about it. So, and same goes, if you speak in your own language and you sing in your own language, that's fine, but English is going to be needed at one step for marketing and promotion. If you go and do an interview, at one time it's going to be a problem if you do not speak English, because media are not going to be able to speak directly with you, or you will need a translator and you will lose part of the, you know, aspect of the interview. Some tips to make a difference, as far as I feel. Don't look old-fashioned, okay? Artists are supposed to be trendsetters, so be up to date with everything which is Facebook, all the social networking, internet and everything. How many of our artists are like, and for internet, how do we do? Do I have to upload myself on Facebook? Yes, darling, that's your job, okay? You have to be proactive on all the social network. If you do not understand anything, try to find someone who's going to explain you how it works. But it's really important right now for you to have direct contact with your fans, and for all the reasons we explained before, and it's really key. Visuals and video content, we need more and more. Lady Gaga has been really good from day one, creating, you know, webisode content of our making of the video. I'm doing a photo session here, blah, blah, blah. So keep on feeding nonstop the people. You cannot just release the album and don't do anything else. It has to come with visual, it has to come with your vision, it has to come with your speech. What are you, who are you, and what's the story? You'd better work, bitch. That's what Lady Gaga told me when she came first time in market. She said, Gigi, if you had one song, you would be RuPaul's song, you'd better work, bitch, because you want me to work so hard. That's the reality. You have to work really hard. Right now, artists who are lazy, especially if you come from abroad, it's finished. If you believe that you're going to sign with a label to go shopping in Paris, that's over, okay? You have to work super hard. They expect you, because you're from international, that you're going to work double. And by working double, you can make it bigger than other artists. Why Lady Gaga succeed? Because she worked bigger than all the other pop acts. All the Madonna, Kylie, Rihanna, they were all, I'm going to go to the Barbade, and I'm going to go on the yacht, and maybe I'm going to sing, but I don't know. They were all kind of lazy at one step and taking everything for granted. She came, she worked nonstop during 1 year, and all of a sudden, because she was everywhere, because the other one didn't want to do that much of promotion or marketing, she took the spot and she became number one. So if you want to take the spot and become number one, do better, do stronger, do harder than the other one who are kind of lazy. That's one of the key. Keep motivating your label and turn it as a team. It's hard to work with people you don't like, okay? It's hard to work with people who don't want to work. So keep motivating your label. It's a really teamwork, and it's so better for us to work with artists we feel are on the same vibe, are giving us ideas, you know, are always coming to us saying, oh, I can do this, I can do that, yeah, that's cool, let's do it, and are happy, than artists who are like, yeah, I don't know what you want to do, I don't have ID, I don't have any feeling, and I'm not happy with what a record company is doing. That's sad, but that's sometimes what we faced, and that's so unmotivating for us. Remain available. That's a good thing if you want to break international and you're coming from this country or from somewhere else. The big stars, they cannot be everywhere at the same time, and they've got their levels and they have to travel the world. And for instance, we've got a lot of international artists, they made it because they are always available. And for instance, Madonna, she cannot be there every 2 days to do promotion or to do all the TV show we would like to do. But the other artist is. So you can take sometimes the spot of artists that are declining or canceling or not here to do the promotion. Use it, okay? Be sneaky. You say, hey, I'm here, I can do that. I can do this one. You want to do a festival? Yes, I'm here. So step by step, you're going to be able to be exposed and break sense to that. Create special link with your label. Be accessible. Being a diva is not working any longer, I can tell you. You better be really close and happy and cool with your people. Working in a label is kind of tough. It was funny before because we had a lot of money, and I mean, no, it was like champagne every time. Right now, it's not champagne, it's fucking hard work. So, you know, if you're nice with your people, that's better. My entourage is what I am. That's really important. Mind the people you're working with, okay? It can be everyone. It can be your manager, it can be your stylist, it can be your hair and makeup, your booking agent. They are representing you at one step in your career. And if you are surrounded by asshole, people will think you are an asshole. Which is maybe not the case, maybe you're super nice. But if you are having a bad manager who is yelling at people, they will feel you're the one telling the manager to yell at people. It's really important, pay attention. And about management, just want something, work with professionals. Okay, don't take your best friend or your cousin or whatever. It's not gonna work, and at the end of the day, you're gonna lose time and money. Work with some people. If someone is coming to you saying, I'm the manager, okay, what are your experience? And if you never worked in the music industry or in the media industry and has no clue of what, you know, the legal aspect are and the rules and being a lawyer is, forget about it. Come with someone who is ready to help you out and can be a real force for you. Keep it simple and cheap. Don't be a diva. That's what I said. You might be, for instance, if you're super big in your home country, some of the artists come in the other market and they say, yes, but I want the 4-star hotel. I want to travel with my jet. I won't do this and I won't do that. No, darling, you're the queen of Central Station for us. Okay, you're not the queen of your village. So keep it simple and cheap. There are a few stuff maybe you don't do any longer in your country. Like, I don't do TV talk show, I just do TV performance because I'm bored with all these silly questions. Well, if you go abroad and you try exporting yourself, you have to reconsider that you are doing everything from day one again and start from the basics. Be open to new experiences. A good way to work abroad is working with local artists. So you can do local duets, you can do featuring, you can work on collaboration, remix exchanges, mutual touring support. Be open. When I was working with Tokyo Hotel, one of the problems with them is that they were so German that anything except them was interesting. Meaning, doing a collaboration with US artists, no way, they are all shit, okay, great. You know, all this kind of stuff, and that's limiting the possibility. Be open, you know, and be open to the culture in general. That's what I'm saying here. Be open-minded, culturally speaking. If you go in a country, you won't say during an interview, well, your country is shit. Okay, you cannot say that. Just try to be open-minded. Speak a few words of the, you know, country you're visiting. Just know a little bit about the country so you can place a few things during the interview. Try to experience new things. I have a lot of, you know, example of American artists coming in the market and you tell them, okay, what kind of restaurant do you want to go? KFC, great. Okay, that's maybe, that's sad for me because when you've got the opportunity to travel the world and discover new countries and new culture, try to embrace it because in return, people will feel it. And when an artist on stage in France is saying bonsoir, hello everybody, speaking a little few words in French, it's making such a difference because people feel he really cares about the market and the culture and everything. Be ready to perform. Live can make a difference. How many artists, I heard the record, I was like, oh shit, this is not good. And I saw them live and it changed my life. I just saw them performing and they were something special. So if you've got a meeting or you can perform, you know, just acoustic with a guitar or whatever, don't hesitate to do it. Live is one of the key of this, you know, business. And that's also the main passion. So as soon as you can show what you've got and you can be, do it. Music is not a science, but it's not a game, okay? There are no proper rules, there are always exceptions, but do not take it too easy. There are rules, there are stuff you have to do, legal aspect is really important, for instance, and there are plans to make properly. okay. How to approach a label right now? Sending demos on a CD, forget about it, okay? It's so 2008. A&R, I know, they don't listen to it any longer. They've got this number of CD coming every day. None of them is coming into their, you know, hi-fi. Use all the internet stuff. So we transfer, you send it, all that kind of stuff. The easiest way, SoundCloud, okay? You send an email, you click on it, you can listen to your track. That's perfect, nothing to download. It's fast and easy, use it. Reach your contact by email, telephone, use social networks. A lot of artists right now, they use Twitter to start, you know, dialoguing with people from the record company, A&R, all that kind of stuff. Use it. Don't hesitate to be pushing. We've got a lot of work, we've got a lot of demand. If you feel that just sending an email or giving a phone call is enough, forget about it. Okay, it's all about, you know, bugging your people and making sure they hear you. Create your own buzz. The more it goes, the more we sign artists because they're already existing in their way. Because they already have that number of followers on Twitter, that, you know, they've got this fan base there, or they heard that they are famous in this part of France, or blah, blah, blah. So if you can create your first little story in your hometown, that's great. Use website dedicated to music. MySpace, for instance, was great a few years ago, and we signed a lot of artists thanks to MySpace, like One Republic, for instance, they get signed via MySpace. Right now it's irrelevant, I would say, but we have new platform existing in France. I gave you the example of Numis, but I'm sure there are different stuff existing in other countries, giving visibility.
Like SoundCloud?
SoundCloud is a good thing, yeah, absolutely. SoundCloud is a good thing. The Hype Machine, for instance, also is good. The Hype Machine, it's called? Hype Machine, yes.
Hype Machine?
Yeah. Yeah. It's hypehem.com. Like a big website, and it's all the key and fashion bloggers who are posting about their favorite topics, and you can vote for the topics you like. So in, for instance, you become number one of the Hype Machine, all the trendy bloggers and key trendsetters are seeing it, and that's good stuff to get some attraction. For instance, Lana Del Rey, she was number one of the Hype Machine. When she posted a video, all the blogger posted it on the Hype Machine, and all the other bloggers started voting for that, and it went number one. The play live in clubs, opening, everything. 50% of the artists we sign them because we saw them live, okay? It's all about being in the festival, opening for different shows. Don't hesitate to show your face everywhere you can. License Angel and Chances. So I don't know if you know it, but there are some people who are taking your music, and after their work is to find you a record deal in different territories. So they take a percentage on the money you're gonna give, you're gonna get from the record company, but they take care of everything. They take care of finding you a label. They are kind of super agent, I would say. They find you a label, they do the deal for you, they take care of the legal aspect. There is one in France called the Sonic Services, or General Overseas in the UK, for instance. It's for mainstream music most of the time, so I would say more pop, dance, R&B, all that kind of stuff. But if you've got a good tour and you already kind of have a success in your country, that can be something interesting. Will TV show can be a good kickoff. Some of the artists, you know, if you win, that's cool. But sometimes we sign artists who are not the winners because they've got something special. So you can also use it. And don't hesitate to travel the world, you know, working on being in fairs and festivals like MIDEM in France, ADE, which is in Amsterdam, and other stuff like that. So that's it for today. If you have questions, just let me know.